The views and opinions of this broadcast do not reflect the views and opinions of Armed Media, UNU Productions and its affiliates. Enjoy the show.
Good evening and welcome to the Leadership with Biana Kovic Show. And thank you for being with us. Our topic, Leadership, focuses on leaders such as yourselves. We believe that leadership is a skill that can be learned through practice and awareness. Our very special guest is Patrick Ward. Patrick is the marketing manager at Dogtown Media, a mobile app development company based in Venice Beach, and is the creator of Words with Ward. A writer by trade, Patrick has worked extensively across the insurance, real estate, finance, travel, and tech industries with notable clients including Allianz, Cathay Pacific, and Fiji Airways. Currently, Patrick lives in LA, having been born and raised in Sydney, Australia, and is a die-hard Steelers fan. He earned his Bachelor of Commerce, Liberal Studies, majoring in Marketing and Political Studies from the University of Sydney. Patrick, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, Biana.
Patrick, you are the marketing manager of Dogtown Media, and also you are the producer of a one-minute video series called Words with Ward. And I was wondering if you can share with us about your work and about the video series.
Yeah, absolutely. So my main role is as marketing manager, the sole marketing representative for Dogtown Media. We're a mobile app development company based in Venice Beach, but we've also got a presence in New York, San Francisco, Boston, and Seattle. And so I was the very first marketing hire. Before me, it was down to the two co-founders to do the majority of the marketing efforts, and then I was brought on. So everything from digital marketing through to event marketing, public relations, any form of marketing you can think of, I have a hand in it. And then on the flip side, I'm also, as you mentioned, the creator of Words with Ward. This is a one-minute video series that I host on LinkedIn. And what I do with it is I interview people and I ask them two questions. I ask them, what is one word people should use more of? And what is one word they think people should use less of? And what I was trying to do with this series is I'm trying to get people to think a little more consciously about the words they use, because I've seen in both the corporate world and the agency world, which are sort of the two main areas, the workforce that I've been a part of, that people unknowingly can influence how they're perceived and how they also think about themselves based on the words that they use. So the classic example of a word that I don't like people to use is the word just. So when you use the word just in an email, you'll often say things like, just wanted to get your feedback. And when it's used in that case, it's a passive qualifier and it makes you sound less sure of yourself. And the sad thing is everyone is an expert in something and they are actually very confident in what they're saying. But by using those types of words, they're actually making themselves sound less confident. So I want people to think consciously about the words they choose to use in their everyday life. And that's certainly my aim with the series Words with Ward.
You're obviously an expert in marketing and in particular marketing, various marketing campaigns. And I was wondering, are the impact words that we can use that can help us move the product forward or put us in a position that people will notice us more?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the funny thing with words, and this is a case of most marketers, they get very caught up with jargon. They'll say things like utilize rather than the word use. They'll use the word like value. I think value is a classic example. Value was a word that we all agreed it had an accepted meaning. And then marketers came along and overused it to the point that the word started to lose its meaning. So the funny thing is, I've seen better success with my marketing efforts now at Dogtown Media than I've ever had in my previous roles. And I can put it down to one factor. I put it down to the fact that all I am doing is telling a story, and a telling a truthful story, I might add, about the wonderful team members that I work with. And that's really what resonates. You don't need to go all fancy with convoluted language. You can keep it very simple. And as long as it is a true story to its essence, that's what other people will relate to. Now, a lot of people say to me, oh, Patrick, you're in marketing. You're in the business of either lying, or you're in the business of sugarcoating. And that, to be fair, is what marketing has got a bad rap for. But at its essence, good marketing shouldn't even feel like quote unquote marketing. It should just feel like storytelling. And that, I think, is what most marketers should take away, that you don't have to put a level of spin on it. You just need to tell the story of who your organization is, what are the values that it stands for, what is your day-to-day like, and those stories are what people relate to.
So what you're saying to us, it's about sharing experience and not being hooked up on the words.
100%. I can tell you that so much of words matter with the emotion that is behind them. And if you have genuine, caring emotions, you know, whether it's happiness, whether it's passion behind the words that you are saying, that is what resonates. The very fact is, words, while they can craft an emotion for us, they still have to be underpinned by both the verbal cues and also the nonverbal cues. So every day when I speak to anyone, I am sending them a message based on what my posture is like, the tonality of what I'm saying. And a lot of that can be influenced by how we're responding to that person. I think this is very interesting within the current context where so many people can be distracted, whether it's by, you know, smartphones is obviously the usual culprit in this. But when you're distracted by that, you're not putting all your intention behind communicating your message. And that's often what leads to people not communicating with each other as effectively, and therefore not building the relationships that are necessary, whether that's in personal or in the workforce.
So how do you move through all that noise and stand out?
I think the key with standing out comes to doing something inherently that is yourself. And I'll use my words with Ward as an example here. So when I was coming up with this series, I devised it purely because I'm a writer by trade. It was my first corporate job, was a copywriter. And so I was always very interested in the way that people use words and the psychology behind that. And so naturally out of that came this idea. Now, that's how I created that series. That's how I knew this could be a series that, one, it would allow me to collaborate with other people, which is one thing I especially love about my job. And two, it was something that, you know, it was replicable. I could keep doing this series, because that's another big problem with social media is you start to wonder, okay, I'm starting to run out of ideas. How do I keep generating content? And you need to keep generating content to keep that momentum going. And so the funny thing is, I didn't look on social to find that idea. I looked within myself to find that idea, crafted that content strategy, and then went ahead and executed it. And the funny thing is, by doing that, I now get frequent messages from people saying, I love your Words with Ward series. There's nothing like it. And that's the key. So many people, when they're trying to craft a message, look at what other people are doing and try and copy it. And by copying it, you just sound like you're just adding to the noise. You're not cutting through the noise. I think Richard Moore, who's a sales coach out of UK, says it best. You need to create an interruption of a person's feed. And what that means is, as we're all scrolling through our social media feeds, you need to be the piece of content that makes people stop, watch it, engage with it, because that is what's making an impact on people, not just the same things over and over and over again. And we all know what these are. These are certain inspirational quotes keep up coming up. Certain things about, there's that word again, value. So many people talk about add value, add value, add value. It's like, well, what does that mean? If you're going to talk about that, give your own personal angle, give a story. That's the funny thing. I always like crafting stories and telling stories because that's something that is unique to me and that's something that someone else can relate to, as opposed to just being generic, saying the same things that the echo chamber often says.
When you're crafting your marketing campaigns, are you looking at your competitors or you're just being very authentic to you or to what your organization or company is about?
Yeah, I mean, you can look at what's out there in terms of the competitive landscape, but I think it really does start from yourself. I think too often we're so obsessed with what other people think, what other people are doing, rather than focusing on what's good about ourselves. I was even taught this lesson from a young age of, you know, strengthen your weaknesses. And in fairness, you don't want to have weaknesses that are so debilitating that they harm you. But at the same time, why would you lean into your weaknesses? Why would you not double down on your strength? Like, double down on the aspects of yourself and the aspects of your company that are so innate that it's just easy, right? We all have things that we personally find very easy to do. And we enjoy doing, and that's really what you can focus on. So with Dogtown, we've found a real niche within healthcare and finance because that's where a lot of our leads are coming in. It's where our best clients are coming in. And so it just makes sense to keep telling that particular story because that is the story that is most natural to us. And every company can do this because every company knows, hey, we've got these 3 to 5 best clients and we always tell that story. Well, you should keep telling that story. Don't focus on, you know, diverting your attention to the quote unquote next big thing. Focus on what you're good at.
So when do you basically say, okay, I have told these stories long enough, I have to now move to telling different stories, or you just keep on telling the same stories?
I think the key there is about experiences. So one of the core values that I believe is that every single person is the sum of their experiences. So why is everyone unique? Everyone's unique because your set of experiences is different to my set of experiences, is different to someone else's set of experiences. And that's, I think, where like stagnation is a real killer for that, because that's when you do start telling the same stories over and over again, and then they lose their power. A funny thing is that a lot of people often tell me, and they say as much, that I sound a lot older than I am. And it's not because I'm physically that much older. It's just literally I've gone out of my way to seek new experiences. So the key is I was in a place in Australia. I was reaching my last year of university, or college as Americans call it. And I had a job. All my friends were there. All my family was there. But I saw in the agency I was working at that the next 10 years of my life were already mapped out. I was seeing people in their early 30s doing the same job that they'd done when they just got out of college. And that very much scared me. I was not going to be in a position where that level of stagnation was going to apply to me. So I literally left it all behind and started a new life in America. Now, most people thought I was mad, but that's the point. Sometimes you need to take those crazy risks. And here's why. Because if it's successful, great. It's successful. That's a win for you. That's amazing. And if it wasn't, and there was a very big chance it couldn't have been successful, then it's a great story. Some of the best stories I tell are times where I monumentally fail. But people laugh and they see that, hey, you're human, just like everyone else.
That's very interesting, you mentioning failure. By the way, I feel there is no failure, there are only lessons. But, you know, I also came to the States 20-something years ago, and obviously there is that fear of failure, of setback. So what is your advice to folks that might want to make that transition like you and I did? What would you say to them if they have to encounter setbacks or failures? What are the best way to move through them?
I think you kind of hit the nail on the head with there are no failures, there are learnings. And I think that's what fundamentally true is that when something fails, quote unquote, it's not actually a failure. It just didn't quite work out for a number of different reasons. And you can do your own, you know, post-mortem analysis of why that was. And then you can find things that do work and then lean into those. Plus, I think when people say failure, is acting like it's so traumatic, it's so disastrous. Let's take that example of me moving to America. What would have failure looked like? Well, it would have meant that I ran out of money, I didn't find a job, which wasn't the truth, but let's just say that that's what happened, and then I would have had to move back to Australia. So I was in literally the exact same position as I was when I left. But I would have learned a whole lot. Now, I'm very fortunate that that's not how it worked and I've been very successful and thriving. But that's the thing. If that's your baseline, if that's really what quote-unquote failure looks like to you, then really the sky's the limit for you. You've got every incentive to go out and craft that life that you want. Because really, when it comes down to it, the bottom is actually not that far from you, but the sky is everything going for you. Mm-hmm. And I think truly people get comfortable. And I always tell people, you need to get comfortable with being uncomfortable, because that's where the growth happens. And ultimately, you get more fun out of life that way. Really, at the end of the day, I think a lot of what we should be trying to aim for with life is a fulfilling life, a happy life, and a very rich life in experiences. And you know these people when you see them and when they talk to you and the way they talk about their lives, it's so dynamic. It's intoxicating. And that's what I think we all should strive for, rather than just being merely complacent with quote unquote good enough. Good enough is an absolute killer when it comes to any sort of ambition, any sort of life that is well designed by ourselves, as opposed to living it because others told us life was meant to be a certain way. I mean, my parents did this, bless them. They said the lesson of you live, you work, you die. And I just couldn't hack that. I just felt that that wasn't a way that I wanted to live my life. I wanted to go out. I wanted to do interesting things. I believe that jobs can be just as exciting and just a bigger part of your life as anything else. You don't work shouldn't just be something that you have to tolerate in order to make money to survive.
So I really am interested to talk a little bit more about the baseline, because this is the first time I'm actually hearing, when I ask people about setbacks, that actually there is no setbacks, because if you were to go back to where you came from, that would be your baseline. So therefore, you would be at the same place where you started. So can you talk us a little bit more about it? Because obviously some people would think, oh my God, I can't go back. People's going to talk about me. You know, people's going to judge me. What are your thoughts on that?
I'm glad you bring up the idea of people who say whether they're worried about others judging them. Here's an interesting psychological trick. Most people are thinking about themselves about 80%+ of the time. They don't have the energy to be thinking about what you're doing with your life. And that's true of all of us. I mean, the very fact is we spend all of our time with ourselves and inside our own heads. And it's very problematic when people say, oh, well, others will judge me. Well, so what? Does that really matter? I mean, I think that so many people need to understand that the right people will support you. And if they're not supporting you, then they're not the right people. It really is as simple as that. And when it comes to that baseline, I mean, the funny thing is I've never been fearful of being let go from a job or fired from a job, because I've held, and this is only in my first, 10 years of workplace experience, I've held 15 different jobs across a wide range of industries. Marketing isn't even the number one industry I've worked in. It's really been a lot of retail. There's been a couple of healthcare jobs thrown in there. There's been a couple of teaching jobs thrown in there. Like, it's just such a diverse range of experience. And what that's taught me is, well, at the end of the day, I trust these sort of core skills that I have, and everyone has these core skills in something. And therefore, that will allow me to make money. And once you accept that level of yourself, that baseline, then really you shouldn't be fearful about pursuing something that you want. I see too many people, particularly here in LA, who are quote unquote shadow artists, where they actually want to perhaps do some writing, but they're tolerating a corporate job because they feel like, oh, well, that gives me the life that my parents told me I should want. And they're miserable. And it's like, why are you living for your parents? You really should be living for yourself. I always say that people need to understand that only you can be your number one fan. No one else can be. So given that, be that fan for yourself. Put yourself number one every single time because you can. And ironically enough, by doing that enough for yourself, you're actually able to give more to others.
I got to compliment you. You have a very high self-esteem, which is pretty impressive because, you know, most people they talk to, they usually like worrisome, concern and other things. So obviously you've gone through many reinventions. And on this show, we talked about the importance of allowing yourself to reinvent. And I'd like to get your thoughts on that.
Absolutely. I think it's all embodied in the fact that my generation, the millennial generation, is predicted to have 7 different, completely different, I might add, careers during their lifetime. Not just different jobs, different careers. And that's, you know, a nature of technology, you know, with Moore's law that technology doubles every 18 months and that cycle is only getting faster and faster and faster. The jobs of tomorrow haven't even been concocted yet. It hasn't even been created. So it's constantly important that you're embracing a learning mindset of learning new hard skills at the same time as knowing that we've all got a bedrock of soft skills that we can rely on, whether that's leadership, whether that's communication. These foundational skills will still be applicable because at the end of the day, we still deal with each other on a human-to-human level, and that's not changing anytime soon. Yes, technology is coming in. Yes, it's bringing things like robots and AI. But at the end of the day, robots and AI aren't buying products and services. People are.
So how do you, from the marketing perspective, how do you turn your followers into customers?
I think the key with that is to focus in on your followers on an individual granular level. So what we often see in marketing, and this has kind of been the case of, you know, through the 80s, 90s, and even the early 2000s, was it was a very mass market approach. It was very much treating everyone as this broad collective that everyone had the exact same mindset. And what we've seen now with this shift is that you need to now get so hyper-specific. If I don't receive messaging from an ad that feels directly related to me, then I'm not interested. And I think that's the key thing that you can really learn from your followers, is that these followers have self-selected themselves because they resonate with what content you're producing. And there's the feedback mechanism. Like never before have we encountered an era where it's two-way communication. And I've seen this with so many companies. They still use social media as just like a megaphone, right? That will post our content, will blast it out into the ether, and then we'll leave it alone. And it's like, why are you doing that? Your audience is right there to speak to, and you really can. I mean, this is one thing that I find very interesting now that I've moved into B2B tech. It's when I post content, the most exciting thing I get is when I get an in-mail message in my LinkedIn inbox, because that's someone who's starting a conversation. And that's really how granular we're going. We're going one-to-one conversations. Now, yes, I can say that that's easy enough for our particular industry being mobile app development. Obviously, our deal size tends to go from about $100,000 upwards. So there's a lot of upside. But at the same time, we're given a unique opportunity to really get into the mindset of our audience and really understand what are the difficulties they encounter in their organizations and therefore how our solutions can help them. And so we're really able to act beyond a company and as a consultant. And I think that's really the type of approach that more and more companies need to start doing less selling and more consulting.
So are you saying to us that you engage the customers and then from the niche that you already have, you create some sub niches, like some groups that you're actually selling the product to?
Absolutely. I think the funny thing is that they self-select themselves into those niches because that's how specific your content should be. Too many people worry about, oh, well, I need the vanity metrics of I need thousands of views, you know, lots of likes, I need lots of comments. No, you don't. You only need one. You only need one right one. And that's really how granular you should go. A classic example that I use, funnily enough, from my previous job is that I ran this Twitter account and we ran targeted Twitter advertising, and that only had 800 followers. And a lot of people said, oh, well, 800 followers, that's nothing. It's like, but that doesn't matter, because that 800 followers equaled $2.2 million of additional assets. So it doesn't matter that that account didn't have 10,000 followers, 100,000 followers. It had 800 followers of the right people. And that's really the way that marketing is going. Marketing is getting further and further in terms of being specific down to the person. That's the way you need to take your messaging, because we're seeing titans of industry. We're seeing companies that were in the Fortune 500 that they used to be there for 75 years. Now the average life cycle of them is 15 years within the Fortune 500. It's only getting shorter and shorter and shorter. And so the companies that survive are the ones who truly do cater to that end customer. I think it is a very exciting time, because it's wonderful to see that companies don't have the sway over us where we just have to sort of live and accept it that, oh, well, I mean, it doesn't really cater to my needs, but it's the best option out there. We're able to see companies crop up overnight that solve true pain points for all consumers and do it in more innovative ways, more clever ways, and ways that really provide solutions that make our lives easier. I mean, that at the end of the day is what companies should be striving to do, make their customers' lives easier.
And thank you so much for mentioning Twitter, because, you know, I was told that you need to have a 300,000 followers or 5 million followers to really be noticed. But what you're saying to us, it could be quite the opposite, right?
Oh, absolutely. I was almost going to say that, you know, you need the 1,000 true fans. I can't remember who said that, but that's the funny thing. I didn't even have 1,000 true fans. I had 800 true fans, and those were the ones that worked. And I think this is true across all of the platforms. So many people get so obsessed with having millions of followers, and it's like, you really don't. You just need to make sure that you're catering to that audience, because those people at the end of the day, if you really show you care, they will return to you in spades. I'm actually a big believer in karma for that very reason, that if I help you, you might not be the one who exactly helps me right in that moment. That would be transactional. But maybe down the line, you'll help me. Or maybe you'll refer me to someone else who'll help me. Or maybe it'll be something as innocuous as I help you, and then 2 days later, someone completely unrelated helps me. And that's really what we should be trying to embody. I think that's the way that we can transform the way companies operate. Because really, if you look throughout the 20th century, companies have still operated almost like a pseudo monarchy, with a CEO at the top who is the top dog, and then you've got all his dominions underneath him. And that hierarchy is very broken. It doesn't work. It makes people unambitious. It makes people demotivated. And it doesn't empower people. The funny thing is, like I said at the very start, everyone is an expert in some area of their life. You as a leader need to just inspire them and allow them, give them the room to be able to come up with those solutions, come up with those innovations, because that's what's going to keep your organization ahead of the game. If you're stifling their creativity, you're only spelling your own death knell for your company.
I really like that, you know, because I am in New York and I worked for quite a few companies, and they still operate in that old system where there is a leader and the others are just like completing their jobs or homeworks. But what I liked is what you're saying to us, there is a person that leads the company, but there are many leaders within that company that are experts, and they themselves are attracting customers or clientele.
Oh, 100%. You don't need a title to be a leader. Particularly in corporate America, we have far too many managers and not enough leaders. A leader will mobilize people to them, draw people to them by their intrinsic essence. A manager has to be put there by an artificial title. I mean, I've always been one who jokes about how titles really reinforce hierarchies that can be damaging for people, where employees feel like they have to obey what that manager says purely because they're a manager. And the funny thing is, I've seen that a lot of Americans have been quite affronted where I haven't, quote unquote, respected the hierarchy. And what is that? That's not me being rude or anything of the sort. It's simply where I speak to managers who are above me, sometimes several layers above me, as an equal. I treat them as a peer. And that by doing that, they also treat me as a peer. They treat me with more respect. And then we are able to engage in an actual dialogue, an actual exchange of ideas, as opposed to this, you give me an order and I just obey it, whether I agree with it or not. Because that also is going to be bad for companies. Because your employees do know what's working in your company and what isn't working in your company. And if you aren't giving them enough trust to come to you as a leader of saying, hey, this is working really well, let's do more of this, or this isn't really working well, we need to fix this. If you don't allow that to happen, then your company will suffer. And then we see this all the time where CEOs say, why didn't they come to me? Well, they didn't come to you because they didn't trust you.
Let's say if the trust has been broken or you did not create that trust initially, what are the ways that a leader can create the trust or bring more trust into the organization?
I think it starts from three things. One, actively seeking their feedback. And there are various tools out there that can do this anonymously, which I think is a very key thing. If you haven't built the trust from day one, you need to find ways that allow your employees to open up to you without it being directly to you. Because obviously, if they don't trust you, why would they tell you what's going on? So a thing that we use is a service called Office Vibe, which allows anonymous feedback. I think that's key. I think it's also key to create a culture of gratitude. So often I see, particularly in the tech space, that because we're so fast moving and we're working within these very disruptive technologies, what happens is that when you get a significant win, we're too quick to move on to the next thing. What I try and do very actively is always showing appreciation for everyone else in my team. And this is very key for me, particularly as a marketer. As any marketer would know, so much of our role is contingent on the help and the collaboration of other people. Whether it's putting together a pitch deck, I'm relying on designers. Whether it's getting a product launch, I'm relying on developers. Whether it's winning business from a lead that I've created, that's down to sales. So everyone needs to work together in order to achieve a marketer's success. So I know that so instinctively that I'm actively always finding ways to show appreciation, whether it's a small thing like buying them a meal, even just a verbal thank you, a real intentional thank you can go such a long way because people do need to hear it when you're appreciative of them. So often we think, oh, well, that person knows how much I appreciate them. Like, well, have you told them? You really need to tell them often, remind them of how much they're valued in order to both foster that culture of gratitude and therefore build that trust. And then the final thing is giving them trust back in the first instance. So what does this look like? Mostly this looks like autonomy. The thing is, when you give your employees the room to make decisions for themselves, they will make decisions in the best interest of the company. Everyone has integrity that can be fostered, can be strengthened, and it's how people want to do well. But you need to trust that they know what they're doing. So don't micromanage them. Don't be constantly looking over their shoulder. If you have a task, listen to their feedback, listen to how they think that a particular task should be done best, and then let them do it. Because that's the real key thing, is that so many managers feel like they have to do that work, manage people. And I think the key is that workplaces are not adult daycares. They're not a place that we need to be watching our employees' every single move. We just need to say, right, here is our company vision and mission. Here is what we are trying to achieve together. And through the recruiting process, we've brought in the right people to do that. All right, now that I trust that you're the right person to do this, go off and do it. I trust you to do that. Mm-hmm. And when you do that, when you show that level of trust in your employees, that's when they will start to open up to you, when they're noticing problems. And then you can solve that in that moment. You can see, oh, our organization's going the wrong way. Now we need to pivot because you've sorted the problem out at its root rather than letting it simmer, fester, and ultimately could bring down your organization.
But what do you say to employees who would say to you, you know what, it's all good, Patrick, I love your thoughts, but my team is very junior and they need very tight oversight. You know, I can't just give them this big idea and have them run with it because they just got out of a college.
I would still say it's not true. Yes, people right out of college need more training, certainly. I mean, I've been there myself. But at the same time, you can still empower them to do an even better job. For example, I recently had an intern who I identified was a really good writer. Funnily enough, his writing style was similar to my own, probably why I found him to be a good writer. But through that, what I learned was, okay, this intern is very good at writing case studies. So I'm going to give him a case study for a particular client, and I want him to come up with what he needs out of it. Now, I trained him earlier on things like SEO best practices. I trained him on the style in terms of, okay, we have a problem, a solution, a result, the format. But at the end of the day, how he went about getting that information and writing up that first draft, I left to his discretion. So his particular methodology was interviewing the certain team members that worked on the project. And from there, he recorded it, he transcribed it, and then he composed it into the case study. Now, yes, of course, as his manager, I still had final review over it, but I left the actual methodology up to him. And it's noticeable. By doing that, he took ownership of the project. And by taking ownership, not only did it get completed faster than I expected, but it was also done to a much higher quality than I expected. If you don't trust your people, even the most junior of people, you're only going to create disgruntlement and resentment. And when people feel resentful, they'll either actively sabotage the task, which is the worst possible option you want, or at the very least, they'll do bare bones effort just to get it over the line. It might be 50% good. You want people to go 90%, 100% of the way. You need to let them take it and run with it.
Because I understand what you're saying. People want to know that they matter and they're being heard and they contribute.
Absolutely. And everyone is. That's the thing. Even the lowliest of intern, all the way up to the CEO, everyone is contributing to the success of that company. However great, however small, it all goes together. It might sound cliche, but teamwork does make the dream work. Nothing can happen in a vacuum. And so you need to show appreciation and trust for every single employee's contribution to the success of your organization. And if you can do that, not only do you make those current employees feel good, you make your workplace an attractive one to work in. Now, this is huge in tech at the moment. In the next couple of years, we're going to have 1 million unfilled tech jobs. It is a huge discrepancy. And that means recruitment is harder than ever. So how do you get people to come over to your organization when they've got tens, if not hundreds of different options? You need to create an environment, a workplace where people are valued so that people stand up, they take notice and go, oh yeah, I'd really like to work at that place because they really treat their employees with respect.
That's very interesting. I did not realize that there is such a huge need for the tech jobs.
Oh, yeah. It's a huge discrepancy, and it's only growing further and further and further.
So how do you evaluate your own success?
For me, success is happiness. And this, funnily enough, is, I think, an Australian attitude that I've still preserved, even though I've now been in America for a little over 3 years. For me, it's about living a life that is fulfilled and that is happy, both for myself, but also for my friends and my family that I care about. And what this means is everything in your life needs to be geared around creating a life that you can be proud and happy of. I always say that happiness is not something to pursue. It is something that is a byproduct of doing the things that you enjoy and also of an attitude that you can embody. We can all look at anything in this world and have a negative or a positive attitude towards it. So it's on us to choose the positive. Now, I understand that there are ups and downs with life. I myself have, you know, encountered many of the ups and many of the downs as well. If anything, the downs have given me the perspective to know that, okay, well, this is a bad situation, but there is a good situation around the corner at some point. That's always what happens. Like, life is very much in a state of flow, I would say, that even when you feel at your most low, at your most sad, there is still a brighter day coming around. And having that perspective is very crucial, because I've seen so many Americans try, and either they're married to their job or they're in the entrepreneur hustle game. And that's all great. It's really important to have goals and ambitions in life. But at the same time, you've really got to look at, are you enjoying every moment or trying to enjoy every moment as you go through your life? Because if you're not, then all you're doing is heaping more stress on yourself, and you're not a pleasant person to be around. I mean, that's really what fulfills us at the end of the day. It's relationships with our colleagues, relationships with our family, relationships with our significant others, relationships with our friends. That's what we gravitate towards. We are social creatures. We always have been, and we always will be.
You know, obviously you're a very balanced person, because I'm guilty of working 80 hours a week at my previous job. So how do you bring that balance into your life if you currently not having it?
I think the key with balance is keeping everything in perspective. And trust me, I've been there when it comes to working, you know, hours and hours and hours. But the thing that I always find to help me recalibrating, now some people find meditation works. I personally have found meditation sitting still not quite working for me. But what I do is I take long walks in a park right next to Santa Monica Airport. And I do this in the night at about 11 o'clock at night. And it's really therapeutic, because it allows me to just walk around, be in nature, and with my own thoughts. And that's really what helps you recalibrate, because we all can relate to the fact that each little thing in work often feels like it's the biggest thing in the world. And yet when you take that step back, you realize, no, that was like a little bit of minutia. I didn't really need to worry about that. Or that deadline was not really a deadline. Really, I could have left a couple more days and not stressed myself out. And by doing that, we really start to get clear in our mind of what matters to us and what doesn't matter to us. And that's really important, that it's so easy to get caught up that if you're always on the go, always hustling, always within that 24/7 mindset, that you're not living your life the way you want to be living it. You're living it just hustling, grinding, almost on autopilot. It's very important to take those steps back. I tell people that when I look at a situation, I look at it from two perspectives. There's the physical first person perspective. That's Patrick interacting directly with another person or a group of people. And then there's almost this third party perspective that is looking at what Patrick is doing and looking at how this is operating in the world. And that I've always found very helpful for me. However you can find to detach yourself from yourself gives you that objectivity. And it's very difficult to do. I mean, we're all guilty of suffering from our own biases, from the stories that we tell ourselves, from the narratives that we've built up over and over many years about who we are, what our lives are like. And so it's always important to find the way, whatever that works, whether it's walks, whether it's meditation, or whether it's music. A lot of people find music help. Find the ways to recalibrate yourself and to get that third-party perspective on your own life.
You know, I really like that you mentioned narratives, because as leaders, we constantly deal with many narratives, our narrative, our employees' narratives, if you're a leader of a country, folks that you're leading narratives. So how can one put that narrative into a wider perspective so that we don't get pulled in into drama of the situation?
I think when we get pulled into drama, it's because we've tied a narrative that we've created to our ego. So the problem with our egos is they can be very often affronted, and we often allow them to be quote-unquote triggered. So if someone says something to me that I don't exactly like every single word that they've said, it's the ego that gets offended by what they say. Now, if you respond right in that moment to what they're saying, rather than take a deep breath, take a moment to think about that person's perspective or where they're coming from, you're only likely to burn bridges and create more problems for yourself down the line, particularly as a leader where you have to navigate, like you say, so many different responsibilities to so many different people, both yourself, but also the people who you are leading. And so I think the key there is try and come from a place of compassion and empathy. And really what this comes down to is emotional intelligence. I think it's the number one trait that any leader should both have and also develop within themselves. Because by having an appropriate level of emotional intelligence, you're able to most effectively communicate with the people that you're leading, but also not get offended when someone comes to you with, say, a piece of feedback that you don't particularly like. You're putting aside the ego in favor of responding genuinely to that feedback. Because 9 times out of 10, when people come to you as a leader with feedback of things either you could do better or the organization could do better, they're doing it because they care. It's not they're trying to be mean-spirited or angry. It's because they genuinely want things to be better. So trust that about other people. Trust that they want the best for you and the organization just as much as you do. I mean, at the end of the day, we all have the capacity for goodness, and we can all strive to embody that and apply that to one another.
And how do you stay humble while leading others?
I think the key there is not putting yourself above others and not thinking you are better than others. So many leaders, or I should say managers, fall into the trap of thinking that they can do everything the best as opposed to their team members. And this flies in the face of belief, because why did you hire all these wonderful team members if you didn't trust that they had expertise that you didn't necessarily have? And that's really the key, to understand that, yes, you might be leading them because you have strong experience. Maybe it's because you motivate people well. Maybe it's because you inspire people well. But at the end of the day, you're learning just as much as anyone else is. We all are still constantly learning new skills, learning new things both about ourselves and about the world around us. So it's very easy to, when you are in the presence of an employee who is an expert in an area, put that guard down. Listen to what they have to say, because funnily enough, you might just learn something, and by doing so, you'll become a better leader of them because you're respecting what they say. You're showing that you care about their opinion, their feedback, their expertise, and therefore they will instill even more trust in you and even more faith in you as a leader. If you demonstrate these qualities to your employees, they'll go into battle for you, metaphorically. They will go to the ends of the earth in order to see that the organization is successful, because you've given them a goal. You've given them a vision of something that is bigger than themselves. We all want to have a very strong impact in both our lives and the lives of people around us. So empower people to do that.
And I really appreciate that you talked about put your guard down and listen. So, my next question is, what are your thoughts on being curious, and how does curiosity helps the leadership?
I think curiosity is so crucial to being a good leader, because by being curious, you're always open to new possibilities, new ways of doing things, and also new experiences. I think one of the key problems that we see in the corporate world, and I've certainly experienced this firsthand, is that people get into a quote unquote, well, that's just the way we do things here. And that is an absolute killer. I would almost quantify it as drinking the corporate Kool-Aid. By doing that, you're not embracing that perhaps there is a better way of doing something. Perhaps we haven't come up with the best solution, and we could even improve further by embracing curiosity. And not only that, but I think it's important just to stay curious from our personal lives, because we will be able to identify opportunities in the world of business by keeping our own minds in our personal lives curious. I come back to my own experience. I was curious enough to leave my own country, not settle for staying with quote unquote what I knew. And I wanted to move to somewhere where, you know, I had a little bit of experience with America, but nothing could prepare me for the amount that I've learned both about myself and about a culture that was completely different to what I'd experienced previously. And that has made me a richer person in terms of my experience. And it's also embraced this idea that at the end of the day, we are all human. And I've found out, funnily enough, the more commonalities that we've shared. But I wouldn't have known that if I hadn't embraced this attitude of curiosity.
And, you know, I agree, we have more commonalities than differences, but sometimes we forget that because we deal with so many obstacles and personal dramas. But I want to ask you another question. Are there any traits that a leader needs to have to be a truly successful leader?
Yeah, I think I touched on one of them, of emotional intelligence, and I think that goes hand in hand with the other key trait of communication. Because I think so many leaders think they need to have certain hard skills. And you see this often in the tech industry, where you've got co-founders that are like very successful in one particular area related to tech. And that's great. But at the end of the day, what really drives change for your organization is your soft skills. Because you're not mobilizing tech, you're managing a team, you're leading a team. And if you're leading a team, you're leading humans. So you need to know how to communicate with them effectively. You need to know how to motivate them effectively. And you need to know just simply how to help them enjoy their work. A classic example I give here is when I was first hired at Dogtown, one of the big key decision points for me was my co-founder, Rob Pope. He was originally from Britain. He spent 20 years of his working life in Britain before moving out here. And he's just a hilarious guy. He really knows how to make a joke, have a good time, and make people feel that sense of warmth that they're valued. That was a big decider for me. And that's really why I chose Dogtown. Now, yes, I got, you know, convinced of the vision, the mission. Mark was very good at saying that. But at the end of the day, why did I choose Dogtown? I chose it because of the people. I chose it for the people-first mindset. That's what you can do with leadership. It doesn't really matter what the actual industry is or what the actual role is, because that'll all change. I'm sure many of us can relate to entering a job and then, you know, 6 months down the line, the job has completely morphed into something we didn't even expect. But what makes us keep coming back to it? What makes us excited to come in on a Monday as opposed to a Friday? It's the people.
And I would also add, it's opportunities that comes with people.
Absolutely. Yeah. You want to be able to work with exciting people, have opportunities to grow yourself and grow together. It shouldn't be so hard. And yet so many organizations struggle to really bring their people together into what I would call, quote unquote, a family environment. And if you can foster that sense of family within your coworkers, they'll stay forever.
And also what I liked, you mentioned that one of your co-founders knows how to have fun, right?
Oh, absolutely. The work is 40 hours of your week. That's a significant chunk of time. Should you not enjoy it, enjoy spending time with the people? I still have a couple of coworkers from my previous role that we are so close that we're still good friends, even to this day, even though all three of us are now at different companies. That's really what you should be fostering in your employees. If they love coming into work, they're going to be more innovative, they're going to be more creative, and ultimately do better work.
Any thoughts for women leaders?
I think the key with women leaders has been the emotional intelligence. And I often said that women have definitely got better emotional intelligence than men. And I think that's one of their key advantages when it comes to the workplace, because that's the fact. We don't live in a hierarchical, tyrannical structure that was characteristic of the 20th century workplace. We live in a workplace that relies on collaboration between people. So they need to focus in on understanding the employees from an emotional aspect. And particularly this is true of America. So much of our self-worth is often tied to our job and tied to our narrative that we tell ourselves about what we do in our jobs and the impact that we have in our job. So you need to tap into that, unlock that, and really make people feel that what they're doing is valuable and what they're doing is valued.
And do you believe that we as people, individuals, can change someone else's life in 20 seconds?
I think so. I think we make very quick judgments about one another. And I think that often some of the most powerful things we do in terms of relating to one another is as simple as saying something that resonates with them, or even more importantly, it's funnily enough, just listening to them, and not listening to them in a way, oh, I'm listening to you, but in a real active listening manner. When people feel like they are being heard, that can be transformational because they feel valued. And that is one of the biggest things you can do for anyone.
And what is your mission in life?
My mission really comes down to helping people to tell their stories in whatever capacity that is. Now, whether that's me telling their story for them or whether it's giving them the right words and the right tool set in which to share their stories. I'm a big believer in uplifting other people. And I think that's really comes back to we are social creatures. And you can be so powerful in both the connections that you build, the relationships you build, and then the words that you use to tell those stories, because everyone does have one to tell. Everyone has had a very unique path through life. And that is very interesting to everyone else out there. Now, a lot of people say, oh, well, I haven't done anything interesting, or I haven't done this, or I haven't done that, and therefore I don't want to share. But the very fact is, well, only you have lived your life. And when you really go back through everything you've done, there is always something interesting to share. You might not think it, but someone else will.
Any final thoughts?
I think everyone can be a leader, and don't let your lack of a leader title, quote unquote, stop you from being a leader. When you are vulnerable with other people, when you trust other people, when you inspire other people, when you motivate other people, when you share your story, you will naturally draw people to you. And that makes you a leader. And given that everyone can be that, I think everyone should strive to embody that. Now, whether it's a leader of hundreds of people, whether it's a leader of one or two, it doesn't matter. By making an impact on at least one other person, you have made a valuable contribution in this life. And it's really what you should strive to do each and every day.
And how can people contact you or learn more about you?
The easiest way to contact me is LinkedIn, linkedin.com/IN/PatrickJamesWard, or one word, or you can find me through my company, dogtownmedia.com.
Thank you so much, Patrick, for being our guest.
Thank you, Biana. This was an absolute pleasure.
Our special guest was Patrick Ward, the marketing manager at Dogtown Media. And with that, thank you for tuning in and listening to the Leadership with Biana Kovic show. If you like the show, please follow me on Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, or Instagram. You can also listen to the past episodes and subscribe to my Leadership with Biana Kovic YouTube channel. I wish you a wonderful evening. Until next time, thank you again and have a great night.